All right, well, congratulations. We are actually at part six of the life map, and that means we're halfway. How many know that after today, we actually only have six more sessions left? I mean, hard to believe that we've actually been going for five sessions here. So we are gonna continue our series on the life map series itself. You can see up here on the life map, I remember the first element of the life map is, of course, what?
The core.
Let's start that off again. No. So the core actually has 10 elements. Did anybody just for fun throw them out there? 10 elements of the core. If you remember them, they were very powerful. Right? The big one is the unconscious mind, right? That's the one that holds all of the repository of everything that we're being. But the first part of the core is something called the higher self, and that's actually the eye-centric sense of self that comes up through the unconscious mind, it comes up through the human psyche, it comes up through our values, through our beliefs, the critical faculty, it comes up into the conscious minds, comes up into actions and behavior, and it ends on a really, really important one called our unique ability. How many know everybody here is special and unique? We have a way that we do what we do. That's actually what makes us valuable and attractive to other people. And then, of course, we take this magnificence, we call it the core, and we push it out into this energetic state. How many know that we're actually, we're meat suits, we have energy, we have vibrational power and force. How many that we actually have enough resonant energy in us to actually light up a city for about a week? Like that's, you know, how many know if they've really got that all spread out? It's about 37 trillion cells in us, right? And each one of the cells is an energy creating being. Did you know that? How many are still with me? Adam's with me.
I'm with you.
All right, yes.
I'm always with you, Casey.
That's right, buddy. So we talk about the power of the core. The core comes down to the energetics. And the energetics is that zero state that we get to begin our day with every single day. We actually get to come up and we start that day. How many know when you opened your eyes today, it was a chance for you to light up the day with a whole new model or version of the world of whatever you wanted it to be? Because we actually are in control of this machine, right? This state, and we can push that energy out. That's what energetics is all about. It's an expression. It's something that we're pushing out. But we live in something called a co-creation universe. What does that mean? Co-creation universe. Anyone?
Everything that you create, you need someone else.
Create it with, right? So we don't live in a vacuum. We actually have to create things through other people. And so being a part of a team, much like the employment team is, you guys actually are having success because of the interaction between yourselves, obviously between the clients, the marketplace, etc. There's a lot of really powerful pieces that go on. And if you really take into the power of relationships, how many appreciated our conversation last week about relationships? Sorry, it was a month ago, yeah. So we talked a lot about, how many know that was a month ago?
Seems like a week
ago, wasn't it? It's true, isn't it? Actually, even as I was driving here, I'm like, wasn't I just here?
Yeah.
Like, you know. So, but yeah, it was fun. But we talked about relationships. Today, we're hitting the halfway mark at something called health. There are three components to health. We're going to talk about mental health, emotional health, and physical health. Today, we're only going to focus on the mental. And we're going to talk about the way our minds work. Coming to our minds are an important piece of the puzzle. They're the ones, that's that part of us that actually talks to us. So the very first subject I like to talk about when I actually introduce life map itself as a whole concept, what I call a high chunk concept. Anyone here know what I mean when I say high chunking? It means to go up into what they call to the macro of ideas versus the micro of ideas. Does it make sense, right? So if you start with, like, give you an example of a micro would be the wheel of a car, would you say that? And then if you take that up, that would be a part of a car. Cars would be a part of a group of movement, which we would call automobiles. Automobiles are a part of a group of concepts known as transportation. Transportation is a part of a group of ideas called movement. I mean, we just went, right? And so that's where you try high chunk. When we look at the mental, or we look overall at life map, the very first concept that comes up is something called model of the world. Model of the world, until you understand model of the world, you really can't see your world in a very empowering way. The model of the world is the way that you see the world. It's the way that you really subjectively see everything that exists in your world. So model of the world is probably the most important concept in your day-to-day life of all the ideas that we teach and talk about in Life Map. In fact, when I walk people into Life Map for the first time, I tell people that the model of the world is where it causes you to be where you are, why you are, what you believe, what your values are. That model of the world is the most important concept. And when we get people into that conversation about model of the world, what it means is you know, that you're really trying to put yourself into a heightened state of awareness. I want to talk about two things when I talk about a model of the world. The first thing is this, is something called subjective reality. Subjective reality is actually looking at the model of the world through your eyes. I mean, no, that your eyes, we're not watching. No, seriously. The model of the world is through your eyes. So that's called subjective. The second is objective. So when you're taking a look at the world, the whole world as a concept, right? Everyone, just for fun, because I see like you've got you drifting here. Everyone here, just picture that there are two parts of our world. One is, let's say, heaven, and the other one is called earth, right? Right in the center of the earth. Let's go to the center of the earth, and we can go all the way up to heaven. If we went to the past, the very last star in the very last universe, and the very last galaxy, the very last of everything, there'd be a place called the black velvetness of nothing. If you reach over and pull that black velvet curtain back, there would be infinite potentiality and God's state so beautiful that it would be mind-blowing. And if I brought that light all the way back down and I brought it through the top of your head down into the center of your heart, and I took that same light and I went all the way down and I put your feet on the ground like the roots of a tree, and I grounded you to that that earth, and I let those roots grow down right through the all the minerals in the soil, down through the gold and the diamonds and pearls and emeralds and all the beautiful things that make up this, right to the very center of the earth, there would be a stone, a little plaque, and it would simply have your name on it. You could hook your little hook onto it like a chain or a very strong rope that would come up to the center of you. And if you attached the heaven and the earth, boom, to each other, and you were in the center of that, and you just pushed yourself down into the ground, it would create a state, wouldn't it? How many are imagining that now? What just happened?
Mind blown.
So if you breathe in, just let it all out. Now you're present, aren't you? Don't you notice now that you're actually more in your chair? Just feel yourself in your chair now. If you actually just take your feet and just feel them into the ground. And then just take the light around your heart and just push it out. This brilliant light that's flowing down through just pushes out. And you woke up every day and you pushed that light around all over everyone and everything that you believe in and that you love and you trust, you would have a model of the world, wouldn't you? If you saw your heart chakra, right, the heart, how many know that the heart itself is a beating electrical organism, right, energetics, and it puts out. Do you know they have a machine that radiates people's energetics, right? There's something called Carillion photography, the energy that measures the energy through light. How many have ever seen it when they hold your hand up to it, they can see all the colors bursting off of it? If you take a leaf and you cut it off a tree and then you put it in front of that, it's bright light shooting off that leaf. If you leave it there for an hour, it dies. The energy force, the life force in that leaf dies, because when you pulled it from the tree, you killed its life force, its attachment to life force. You and I have a heart that radiates energy all around us. Goes out about 27 feet. That's why when someone comes into the room or someone leaves the room, we leave that energetic field, it creates this impact. How many know when some people walk in, it's like they let the room lights up, right? That's, I think, who we want to be. How many know I just described to you a model of my world? How many like my model of the world? Kind of fun. Right? How many model of the world's a little different than the average person's, right? So that's what I do every day. When they say, so what do you do when you wake up? Well, I go up right to the very last, to the literally the black velvetness, and I pull it back and I reveal the luminescence of God's presence. And I take it all the way down, boom, drop it in, and then I anchor myself to Mother Earth. Pull it up. I mean, that's pretty weird.
It's my son's favorite meditation.
Oh, is it? Very good. Very good. So how many, that's a wonderful way to live, right? Now, that's a model of the world. That's a subjective reality for me. I made it up. I'm kind of happy with it. Works for me, right? Model of the world really is our everything. If I live subjectively or I live objectively. If someone came in the room, saw me in the middle of talking about the things I was talking about, but had no attachment to it, they would literally think I was a nut bar. Would you agree? Little nut bar? Big nut bar. Okay. They would say, well, whatever that guy's talking about, right? Because they would have an objective state because they were not in my subjective relationship with them, right? So what we do with people is we try and give them a model of the world that serves them. How many know a model of the world is designed to serve you? Do you realize that you're allowed to make up whatever you want to make up and make it true for you? It's not true, it's just true for you. So what's the most important thing to know about model of the world? Number one, it rules your life. It rules your world. Number two is, it's all made up. It's all made up. There's no out there. There's only in here, looking out there, making stuff up. I mean, no, that's really what we're going to talk about. Point number two when we talk about mental health is something called mind projection fallacy. Mind projection fallacy is where literally, if you Google it, it's really kind of cool to look it up. It isn't true, it's just true for who? True. How many know you have your own projection that you're putting out there? So I have a model of the world that I put out there that I believe is true about me, I believe is true about like, you know, the life that I live, and it's just my model of the world. It's my subjective model of the world. I get to make it up. However, right, I also have to stand in objectivity, which is say, well, if somebody that doesn't know me walks in the room and doesn't know Casey, they're just gonna see me from an objective state going, crazy guy talking, right? Right, crazy guy talking, right? Because if they didn't have any connection to what I'm talking about, they would literally go, I don't know what that guy's talking about, because they would have their own model of the world, and it may not include my model of the world. How many have ever met somebody where you go, that person's crazy, like I do not know what they're talking about? Have you ever met a client where you're like, really? Like, I may have ever dealt with a client recently where you're like, they are like in a model of the world that I didn't even know existed. How do they function? Here in the Durham region, how do they function? How do they actually drive a car? I mean, have you ever met people like that? Like, but that's their model of the world, and their model of the world works for them. So what's the greatest thing we can learn about our health mentally is to be subjective and objective as often as you need to. So subjective being in your model of the world, painting your picture, making it all up, making sure it serves you, making sure you get everything out of life that you want, and then at the same time go, I'm a little bit crazy, I believe that, but I'm okay with me. I'm not saying that. You actually have to step away and go, how many know your way that you see the world isn't right? It's just right for who?
You.
It's just right for you. And if you can get into peace with that, then you get to go, oh, I get it. I'm not better than anyone. I'm just different. I just see the world differently, and it's good for me. Because we get to make up what we ever want to about whatever we believe is good for us. Model of the world. Powerful, right? Miranda? How powerful has it been in your life? Model of the world.
It's fantastic because it allows me to be objective with my clients, for sure. Like, trying to get into their model of the world so that I can sell them something and kind of understand that craziness that goes on, right? And realizing nobody sees the world the way I see it.
Nobody.
So I try my best to communicate that to other people and communicate it in a way that they're going to understand it.
That's right. Yeah, that's brilliant, because what you just did was you realized the value of the model of the world was knowing that you weren't right, but you had your own version, and you're happy with your version. If you're not happy with your version, you know you can change it, right? Mm-hmm. You just make a new one up.
Yeah.
Say, I believe this today, right?
Yeah.
And it's your right to be fickle. Like, I don't choose this today, I'm going to choose this, right? That's actually the rights of it. The magic of it is to be objective to it. Right, and then just keep adding to it. Is this working for me? 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 How many of you get to keep making it up and making it better over and over and over again? That's what I love about it. There's a magical part of the brain that we want to talk about because we're in mental health. There's model of the world, right, we've talked about. There's mind projection fallacy, which is the objective subject reality of what we make up. But there's this special mechanism in the brain called the RAS. And the reticular activation system is a very powerful piece of the puzzle. Anyone here know what the RAS is? Adam, you remember what the RAS is? You use it all the time. RAS, Deshane? No? RAS.
It's essentially a filter, right?
Okay, yeah, gotta take it. Keep going.
I don't know, the best example I can give is a car, for example. You're seeing all these cars. You're looking to buy a BMW 4 Series, and it's not until you're looking to buy that car you start seeing all these cars
around. Very good, very good. So the reticular activation system is a targeting mechanism that we switch on in the brain to alert us that something is within our proximity. So for example, when people, you know, when people kind of get into that sunken state of defeatism and it's like, nothing ever works for me, nothing ever worked for me, nothing, everything's going bad, everything's going bad. When you get into that state, guess what the RES does? It goes, is it bad? Is things keep getting bad? Guess what it keeps feeding you? It keeps feeding you everything you keep asking for. That's the magic. The magic is you can switch the RAS on and get it to work for you, or you can switch the RAS on and get it to work against you. And this is where, when you see people get into a defeatist mindset, what happens is that we end up in this state where, quite honestly, it's very frustrating for people, right? People get very, very frustrated because they don't know. How many have ever heard, when it gets bad, it seems to get worse and worse and worse and worse. It's almost like this spiral effect. The good news about the RES is it works on whatever you give it to work on. So if you tell it to look for opportunity, boom, it switches on. It starts opening up all these vessels. Now here's what's interesting. What's happening in the real world is like zero. Like it's like it's like mind projection fallacy. There's all that's happening in the world in real time is truth. We are subjective, right? We're filtering the truth of what's happening. When people open up their RAS to look for more clients, to get involved, to be clients of theirs, the clients were always there. I mean, the clients were always there. Our filters were blocking our ability to see the clients. Does it make sense? So depending on where our filter is at, sometimes our filter is right here and we can't see anybody. There's no clients, nobody's selling, and there's nothing going on, and then the filter gets wider and all of a sudden it's like there's people everywhere. Have you ever gone through moments just like, boy, there was nobody last week, and now there's like everybody this week? I mean, you know what I'm talking about? That's because our filters are switching on and off. We're teaching ourselves to look for what it is that we want to find. So if you're going to write down anything about the RAS, we teach ourselves to look for what we want to find. The RAS is the machine that switches on. Just a fun mechanism. It actually, they discovered the RAS is also our alert system. So it's actually like an alarm system. It's like a wake-up call. That's what the RAS really is. It's also attached to the sleep cycle of human beings. So how many wake up at the same time every day? And I have like this little doot, you know, it's like 6:55. Oh, 6:55. Why am I awake? It's like, well, because it's 6:55, and I always get up at 6:55, right? Now, how many know what that? That's actually the RAS in full alert. It's always going, I'm good. You just do whatever you need to do, but I'm like waving a little flag over here. If you want to have some fun with your RAS, say, I want to wake up tomorrow and pick a strange time, and just before you go to sleep, here's what you say. You say, dear unconscious mind, I'd like to wake up tomorrow at 7:23. Why? Because nobody wakes up at 7:23. Just for fun, right? Put it in there and just watch what happens. Do you wake up at 7:23? Do you really?
No, that's asleep. Almost to work by then.
Yeah, that's right. So how many know what I mean? Like you just put in like a weird time and just wake it up just for fun. That'll show you the power of it. If you want to attract more deals, you need to put into your reticular activation system exactly what you want it to find. What do you want it to find? I want a client that's selling this range of houses, and I want them this, I want that. I want it to be this level of effortlessness. I mean, pick it. You get to make it up. It's all made up anyways. And you get to put it out there and get it to switch on for you. Now, how do you actually get the RAS to work for you? You can think it. That'll bring in one degree of intention. How many know if you were to actually write it, what would happen if you wrote out what the intention was with the RAS? What happens with that? What's it do? It heightens it, right? And then if you actually get even more specific, like you put a time or a date, better known as a SMART goal, you put it tight, even tighter, you tighten it down, that's when it goes vertical. So the RAS works for us all the time. That's the good news, and that's the bad news, because it'll cycle you up or it'll cycle you down, depending on what you're focusing on. That's called the reticular activation system. So when people come to me and ask me about dreams and goals and in case, you know, how do I get my mind to work for me? I tell everybody this story of what I call the black, white, and gray. So I believe that most people have thoughts that are, I'm going to use a color coding system of, when I have a thought that's hope-filled and dreamlike literally a loving thought of something I want to have happen, I color it white because I think it's like the pureness of white. I mean, how many can picture a dream trip right now and it's just like the perfect trip? Or you picture a dream situation, like a dream series of clients. So like you sell X number of houses in X number of days and it just, you make X amount of commissions. You're like, oh my God, that'd be amazing. That's the white, that's the pure whiteness of it. at the same time that you're having that perfect white thought, you also equally have a part of you that's not so pure. I mean, how many know that there's a not so pure part of you, right? That's what I kind of think as the doubt thoughts or the black thoughts, the darker thoughts of like, well, I've got my clean, pure white thoughts and I've got my darker, cloudy, you know, not so pure thoughts, right? Well, I'd love to travel. I'd love to have that. I'd love to have that home. I'd like to buy this car. I'd love to have these type of clients. I'd like to have, you'd like to have, I'd like to make $1 million commissions this year. I mean, you could paint that picture. But then as soon as you paint that picture, even as the brush stroke is going across in pure white, at the same time, there's a whole series of thoughts that are right behind it. What are those? That's the doubt. That's the fear. That's the worry. That's the part of you that's the realist. Oh, how could you even put that out there? That's ridiculous. How many know what I'm saying? So as the white thoughts go this way, the dark thoughts almost come in behind it, right? And what do they start to do? Whatever you put this way, if you put a how many have ever worked with paints? If you put a white paint this way and then cover over with dark paint, what happens to it? It turns into gray, doesn't it? So when people say to me, how come the law of attraction doesn't work? Or how come I don't get what I want in my life? I say, well, it's not that it doesn't work, because the universe is infinite and you're infinite and you have infinite possibilities and you get to make up anything you want to. And I mean that with all sincerity, you make up whatever you want to. It's that you just spend an insane amount of time taking all the purity of what you really want and then just contrasting it with all these thoughts that don't serve you. And because the reticular activation system works, and it works very, very well, it gets you not what you want, but it gets you a version of it. How many have gotten what they wanted but got a version of it? Or you went, well, it kind of worked out, but not really got everything I want. How many I'm saying? It kind of worked. Sometimes you dream this, didn't have any doubts, and it went whoop, like that, and you got it like that. You're like, dude, that was awesome. I got exactly what I wanted. In fact, it got better. And whenever I had that happen. That's where you just paint it white and then keep painting it white and then you gloss it over and then you put another lacquer cover on it and another more white. I mean, it's just like, boom, boom, boom. It takes it to the highest level. No doubt. It's like, whatever. And even if a doubt flows in, you've got gloss lacquer over it, so it just can't even stick to it. Do you know what I'm saying? And then you start attracting. That's the power of the mind. The mind will work for you, right? It'll serve you, but you have to get it to serve you. And you have to know how you work in order for that to actually work for you. Make sense? Adam?
At the beginning of the year, me and Gino had a conversation because I know he didn't get off to the start that he wanted to. And I just said, just write down and tell yourself you've already sold 15 homes. He's like, but I haven't. I'm like, but you have. I'm like, all you have to do is make it up. I'm like, write it down on the board. Say, I'm an amazing realtor. I've sold a ton of homes and I'm going to sell a ton more homes this spring. What'd you write down on your board after that conversation we had?
Yeah, something in regards to that. Weren't you making fun of me because it was on my whiteboard? I actually did it.
Yeah,
did it work?
Did it work?
Yeah.
So what did it do to your mindset when you started actually physically writing it? Like, did it change your mental?
Absolutely. I wasn't keeping it right in front of my face.
What did it do when you were actually writing it onto the board?
It was empowering, I guess. Not I guess, it was. Because then you start getting into that mindset, and then, like you said, start attracting those opportunities to be consistent with what I was putting
each time. Absolutely. You know, we really get to make it up. And I know I sound a little bit like I'm repeating myself. Stop and think about the phrase. It's a quote that I made up years ago, and I said, there's no out there. There's only in here, looking out there, making stuff up. What did I just say? There's no out there. Miranda.
It just reminds me, when you change the way you look at things, the things that have changed, it's the same thing, right? Like, you get to make up whatever it is.
Whatever it is.
Right? And everybody has a different interpretation of what that's going to be.
Do you know the interesting things I found? If we have a model of the world, and we tend to share it or project it out maybe around our friends, then we come up with new revelations that are, it's like a better version of the model of the world because then we get to make new stuff. But it's almost like we hold on to the old stuff so our friends don't think we're crazy because we changed our mind. Does that make sense? It's almost like this, like, well, I can't tell them I'm more excited now or I have bigger dreams and goals because that'll make me sound crazy. So we actually get almost like we get socialized into a series of states and conditions that don't empower us or give us more, because if we're not around a supportive group, that can actually, that can undermine us, that can hold us back. And that's not true for everybody, but I find that for the majority of people, if you actually, if think about what, there's no out there. Bill says, William Shakespeare? Bill said?
Nothing is right or wrong, thinking makes it so.
Nothing's neither good nor bad, but thinking make it so. We're talking about mental health today, right? Mm-hmm. Nothing's neither good nor bad, but thinking make it so. And I use really kind of extreme examples like child labor. Remember we talked about child labor and everyone's like, ah, that's bad. I said, yeah, except they'd be dead if it wasn't for some guy paying them a dollar a day to make a t-shirt. Right? Which one? Which of the evils do you want? Dead or child labor camp when they get to, you know, unmanageable ages, they just kick them out on the street anyways, but now they have some resourcefulness. They're not 3 or 5, now they're like 10 and 11. Like, it's still negative. I mean, it's I don't like it. Does anyone here like it? I don't like it. But it's difference of, if subjective is my emotions hurt because it's a child. I get that. Right? Do you know they're killing children every single day by the hundreds of thousands? That's how the world works. Objectively, stand back and go, child labor's bad, but if I step back and go, at least they have a place to live and food. Right? Like, so you have to stop and say, oh my God, you're right. So nothing's neither good nor bad, but thinking of it. So here's the next one. Nothing has any meaning except the meaning we give it. Nothing has any meaning except the meaning we give it. Tim Hortons is good. Tim Hortons is bad. Tim Hortons is, Starbucks is, Starbucks is, So we did, everyone's like, huh? He's got a Tim Hortons, he's got a Starbucks. How many get, like, it's not true. There's no truth there. Like, how many know the coffee at Tim Hortons is not better than the coffee at Starbucks? Why should all your brains go, oh no, it isn't, it's better, it's not. Your brains are going to have a subjective opinion. It's not true, it's just true for you, right? Because you're not the authority taste bud for coffee beans. I know that's hard to believe. But do you understand what I'm saying? If you can step away from almost these series of biases that screw up the way you could see the world. There are people having meetings today on how to move $100 billion. You know that? There are people in meetings somewhere in the world right now on 100 million, 100 billion. There's how many deals that are just so gigantic that you're like, what? You know, like craziness. And there are people today that are talking about, you know, how we're going to save more money at our particular donation clinic and make $10. Do you understand? Like, it's all subjective. It's all, everyone's got their own reality. It makes sense? The key in mental health is to make sure that you know how your brain works so you can switch it to give you the power to get what you want at any given time. So the tools we're talking about is model the world, mind projection fallacy, reticular activation system, the black-white of, or you know, the gray effect of what we call black and white thoughts. Now, one of the things I wanted to talk about was the whole idea of learning how to protect yourself from yourself. Anyone here ever had a bad day?
No, never.
Just Miranda. Okay, and now I had one. You had one?
Yeah.
Okay. In those bad moments, learning how to protect yourself from yourself is absolutely critical. True success, truly successful people know that every day is not going to be a 10. Truly successful people know that every day is going to be a series of rides. Because we're not just meat suits, we're emotional beings that have mental thoughts. Would you agree? And we're inside of a meat suit, a physical meat suit that's got all these chemicals going up and down. Right? Because when he drinks that coffee, is it cream, double? What is it?
Two cream, one sugar.
So a little bit of dairy and a little bit of refined sugar. Fantastic. So what do you think that's doing to his insulin levels right now? Right? Like, so we could say, he's like, no, it doesn't affect me. How does he know that? Until he purifies his body and actually brings it back to its original state, he has no idea what that product is doing to his mental, emotional, and physical state. Would you agree with me? Like, whatever is true will be true for him, but I'm just saying, all these chemicals coming in and doing all these things are creating this life that we have. So when I talk to people about protecting themselves, the first thing you have to do is you say, well, I gotta learn what makes all this come about. Like, what are all these thoughts that come in? So we have something called little voice management. How many know we have a little voice? Anyone here have a little voice? I mean, how many of it's actually quite loud, actually? It's like more like these, like as opposed to this, right? It's like this going on. What's that?
It's my inner squirrel.
Your inner squirrel, nice. Okay. Squirrel's an interesting choice of words.
Monkey
mind, there's lots of terms for it, right? So when you're talking about protecting yourself, anybody know why you have that little voice, anyone? Anyone? What the little voice is itself, anyone?
Isn't the little voice everything you've ever been exposed to or heard or had?
Right.
So it's
written on your glasses.
Perfect. Okay, so what we know is this, is the voice, the little voice, everyone listen to the little voice and say hi to itself. Okay? Okay. If you can observe that, that's not you. Did you hear what I just said? Want me to do it again?
You can observe it. It's not you.
So you know that voice that you're listening to? You know how that, have you ever been caught, Vanessa, talking to yourself? Oh, yeah. Have you ever caught yourself talking to yourself?
I'm shaking his head.
Oh, actually, funny, the other day. No, it's not to do with Vanessa. I was doing measurements, and I'm just like, sorry, guys, I just talked to myself a whole lot, so just don't mind me. And they're like, okay. I already had the listening by that point, so they didn't think I was nuts.
Yeah, yeah. Well, they knew you were nuts. They just were trying to put it in a category.
Yeah.
Right kind of nuts for them to sign the paperwork.
That's right. Sign hard, press three copies. So, So what's interesting is this, is that everybody has the self-talk. The self-talk is not you. It's a series of accumulative effects of this thing called life. And it's a series of things that you're measuring against. So for example, if you find yourself in rumination or talking to yourself, what actually is happening is you're reflecting on all of your past experiences to put things into context. You're trying to contextualize what it is that you're experiencing. Does that make sense? That's why, you ever think about, why do I talk to myself? It's like, oh, I'm talking to myself, it's kind of weird, but you talk to yourself because you have this whole massive inventory of thing of something called life experience, and it's a whole series of causes and effects. Does that make sense? And every time you're doing something, you're measuring, should I do this? Should I do that? You're measuring against the series of inputs that you've received over 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years. So all you're trying to do with that is learn how to contextualize it. That's it. That's what self-talk is. The downside is if it starts to go against you. How many know you start to look at things a certain way? You start saying, well, you know, every time I do this, X happens, right? It's not true. It's just a series of references that you've chose to randomly select. Does it make sense? You can look for anything good in any. How many know this story? The kid runs in a room, is full of horse manure. The kid's very sad.
Oh, yeah.
Right? And the other kid walks in the room, right? Starts throwing the manure everywhere. There's got to be a horse in here somewhere.
Yeah.
Right? Everyone's got, how many know you got a model of the world, right? Everyone's, some people come in with a negative, some come in with a positive, right? You come in looking for whatever it is that you're looking for. Learning how to protect yourself from yourself is the number one skill that you can have as an agent, as a life partner, as a human being. It really is. Learning how to say to yourself, is that true? Nothing has any meaning except the? Nothing has any meaning except the meaning we give it. First key. Second thing is this. When we talk about the whole idea of managing ourselves, is we have to manage what we want as the outcome. Because we can't manage the events. Stuff is going to happen to us. Like we could walk out this door here and trip, or we could walk out the door and someone could hand us a bouquet of roses. I mean, we have no idea what could happen as soon as we go out the door. Does that make sense? There's a whole series of events that are going to happen in real time, 24 hours a day. They're constantly happening to us. Would you agree? It's not the event that is important. It's our response to the event that is important. Learning how to protect yourself in, like if something happens to you, that's a victim mindset. But if something happens for you, it's an empowerment mindset. Key nugget, nothing happens to you. Everything happens for you. If you can get into that model of the world where nothing happened to you, that everything is happening for you. Even if you lose that listening, but you find how many of you have, you know these stories anyways, right? You know, you go to sell them this home, there's 10 offers on it, they get knocked out, but they find the next home and it's a dream for them. You know these stories, we do these stories all day, right? But there's a big formula that plays out in the game of life, and it's called E plus R equals O. E plus R equals O. How many have heard of it before? Okay. There's an event, there's a response, there's an outcome. When people ask me how I stay so calm sometimes, a lot, Casey, how do you stay so level-headed? Because it takes insane amount of craziness to actually get me mad now. I used to be the kind of crazy person, you know, when I was younger, because I kept thinking things were happening to me. Then I realized that I was just a meat suit walking through the universe having stuff happen, right, based on my energetics. Whatever I was putting out, I was bringing back. What you think about, you bring about. What you think about, you bring about. This is known as the reticular activation system. If you think about X, it brings back X. If you think about Y, it brings back Y. So if there's an event and there's a response, right? It's so funny. I was driving the highway. Someone, of course, you know, they came up. I was in the fast lane doing 125. I was thinking, okay, I'm doing 125. This guy comes like right on top of me, right? I'm like, what the heck, right? So I, you know, tried to get in front of the next car, pull over. He's giving me the finger on the way by. I'm waving at him, hey, how are you? You know, because like, because my model of the world was like, oh, okay. Because to me, I just think it's funny personally, because I know that nobody's actually, there's no such thing as road rage. Somebody actually was in rage and got in behind the wheel of a car looking for an incident. Does anyone understand? Like, there's no such thing as road rage. It's not possible for someone that you've never met to actually enrage you. What did I just say?
It's not possible for someone you've never met to actually enrage you.
It's because you'd have a completely objective experience. Right? If someone walks down the hallway, it's like, you walked down the hallway, you pissed me! I mean, that'd be a little bit... We need to send you to other rooms, right? Other than this one. So, you know, right? It's in, like, you know, you have to be in rage and targeting, looking for a way to express the rage. Road rage doesn't exist. People who are in rage are now behind the wheel of a car.
Got triggered.
They were looking for it. So true about life. Nothing has any meaning except the meaning we give it. So there's an event. Casey's driving at 125 in the fast lane, which is usually, you know, 120, 122, 125. That's enough for a good ticket, and you know. But I'm like in fast lane. This guy's right up behind me, and I'm like, oh, okay. And I just sped up a bit, got myself up to 130, pulled in front of the next car, and he's like, oh, yeah. I'm like, hi, how's your mom? Oh yeah, you'd slow down, wouldn't you? You'd go slow down, drag it back, yeah. How you doing? Right? But there's an event, you get to choose your response to produce an outcome. So my attitude is, if Road Rager comes up behind me, I get to do one of two things. I get to enter into rage with him, right? Slow down, finger him off, maybe we pull off, like, you know, two X's from now, have a fist fight, get the Durham region involved. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Right? Do some jail time, fantastic. There are people who chose that. Right? Did you hear about the motorcycle guys in Toronto that did that? Got into an incident with a car, ended up with one guy dying, the whole bit, cars crashing and motorcycles flying everywhere. Oh yeah, crazy stuff. And the point being is this, is that these guys were what? There was an event, there was a response, there was an outcome. So here's how I see my life. So we're talking about protect yourself from yourself. Here's how I see my life. There's nothing that any of you in this room could, this is just my model of the world, but there's nothing any of you in this room could do to me that would cause me to choose to be angry. If you said something to me or did something to me, because my outcome is that I love everybody in the Dan Plowman team. I'm here as a support mechanism. I'm a person that's here to serve and give and do whatever I can to be of value and service to all of you. I mean, that's my model of the world. So I already picked my outcome. Does it make sense? I've already selected it. Okay, let me use another example. I have six beautiful children, 21 to six, right? And when my kids lose their stuff, I mean, I'm like, I have already chosen my outcome with my children, right? I already know that they're losing their stuff because they've lost perspective of something. They've given meaning to something that's not true, but it's true for them, right? Because when their sister looked at them the wrong way and he was holding the controller, he lost the game and the sister went like that, and that meant that he was lesser than, how many know that? He was in the middle of an event, right? And he chose a response that's not working for him. The father's responsibility is to love unconditionally, right? So when he lost his stuff, I sat him down and I said, look at me, okay, you're good. Everything's fine. How many know the kids that their job is to continue to have a response? My job is to continue to have an outcome.
Right.
What's my outcome with my children? To be a loving, supportive, fun parent. That's my model of the world. You can put whatever model you want on it. Right? I'm a loving, supportive, and fun father. That's my three modus operandi with my children. Loving, supportive, fun father. So when my kids are in my presence, all six of them come in and drop their stuff. They create events. My response is, I'm a loving, supportive, and fun father. I mean, that's pretty cool to have the outcome as my response. If you are a world-class real estate agent in the Durham region, you have clients that are going to give you events. They're going to, how many have ever had difficult clients that have verbalized their diarrhea out of their body? They just say all this negative stuff. Your response is to pick the outcome first, right? Whatever your model of the world is for how you're going to be a world-class agent, if you pre-write it out, no matter what event takes place, you always show up being. So whether I'm being a father, or I'm being a business owner, or a coach, whatever the model of the world is, I always begin with the end in mind. I always begin with my outcome. This is who I be. Therefore, this is what I do. Questions, comments, compliments, because it's a tough one. But if you get it, it's like the number one way to protect you for the rest of your life. Because nothing happens to you, it happens for you. All the good and all the bad. You can't just say, when bad things happen, you can't say, oh, well, that was happening to me. No, that makes you a victim. If a bad thing happens, an event happens that you perceive as bad, it's only you perceive it bad because that's where you're at right now. It's not true. It's just true where you are right now. Does it make sense? You following along? Because if you can grab this, you'll live a very happy life.
One of the easiest ways I ever learned to do that, I'm sure it was from you, is when people are in their response, just understanding it really has nothing to do with you, like the road rage guy who knows what put him in rage in the first place, and it's just to simply say, that's not me, or that's not about me, and just carry on your way. Whereas before, I was the first to just, you know, if my husband comes to mind, I would just jump down his throat, like, because he was reacting a certain way to something. It's none of my business how he reacts to something. He's got something going on. So now we always say to each other, are you aware of what's really going on? That's our thing back and forth. And it'll be like, oh. Or he'll get upset at one of the kids, and I'll say, do you know what that's about? Do you know what's really happening there? And it really, really
slows things down. Yeah.
Deal with the response, for sure.
Yeah. This is this formula is magical. This, I believe, is the formula that truly separates the average from the exceptional. This is the difference between, this is where emotional intelligence, I've met people with IQs that are vertical, 140, 150, I'm married to one. I mean, but until someone who's high IQ doesn't match it up with a high EQ, they're in trouble, right? Because they're going to operate from logic. That happened to me. That's how it is. It's a thing. They get almost robotic. Oh my God! It's like they're caught in this myopic state. Myopic being narrow-minded. But someone who's in emotional intelligence, they're actually seeking awareness. They've already chosen the outcome. I'm like, this is how I'm going to be. I'm a fun, loving, supportive father. That's what it is, Joss.
So is there a gray area, an in-between area between the militant one and the rosy-colored everything's perfect? Like, is there not a response where, I'm not an overly angry person, I would be more of a hurt person, right? So if in a personal circumstance, and it's real and it's happening,
yes.
And the response would be, expressing you hurt me.
Yes.
Why did you do that? Like that's part of that, no?
Perfect. You did a perfect job.
Okay.
Yeah. So you know what happens to most people who get hurt? They never say it.
Right.
Oh.
Okay.
Hurt me, eh? You sleep in that, right? Do you close both eyes? How many know that's a completely different response?
Yeah.
But if I say something and you go, Casey, like, wow, that really hurt me. Like, how many know that she's now doing what? She's expressing it. It's not going in, it's going what? It's going out. She's not getting into a rage state. She's saying, this is what happened to me. My response is, she can still be loving, supportive, and fun, and say, listen, Kenny, like, why did you say that to me? That really hurts me. You know how sensitive I'm about that. Could you tell me why you said that? I mean, that's still loving, supportive. It still meets her model of the world and expresses it in a loving state. Does this make sense? I mean, that's how we deal with stuff. Not we don't do it perfect all the time, but it's like I find the majority of the time is because we're constantly saying, listen, nothing that the people in my life can say to me, right? I use Tammy as an example. Tammy has the stress of the entire team on her shoulders 24 hours a day since I've known her for 7 years now. I mean, there are times I call, hey, Tam, how you doing? Fine, yeah, everything's great, woo, yeah, blah, blah, just came back from trip, blah, blah, kids are great, blah, blah, right? I've called Tammy and she's like, oh. In fact, she makes that sound. Ooh. I'm like, ooh, that's the sound. I mean, no, then I listen because I'm trying to hear what? I'm trying to hear what's stated. That doesn't mean that she's that way. That just means that she's experiencing it. Next week or next month, we're going to talk about emotional health. And emotional health is what you just talked about, Josh, which was this. It's like emotional health is actually not being sadness. It's experiencing sadness. Like, I'm feeling sadness right now, but it's not you. How many know we're allowed to experience sadness? It's just sadness isn't who we are. And that's that fine balance. So what we're here trying to do is get you into this formula here. Take it to everything. In fact, share it with your clients. Say, hey, listen, we're going to go in this offer. There's 10 people on this thing. Like, this is, like, let me just manage your, I mean, that's called managing the client state, right? You manage the client state and say, listen, I'm going to be honest with you. In this crazy market, right? We just, Sandra's parents, they live in this community where the houses sold like for $300,000, like 7-8 years ago. A house just closed. It went up at 830, sold for $1,022,000. You guys know these stories, right? You're like, what? Like, there's no rhyme or reason to this. I mean, no, I'm talking about, it's just like the markets are completely all over the place. So managing the client state, saying, listen, let me put you into an outcome state. No matter what happens, we will find your home, or we'll find the right buyer, or whatever, whether it's someone you're buying, right? And what you're trying to do is this, is you're trying to manage their outcome by managing, because you know they're going to have some emotions, right? They're going to have some events happen in the offers, there's going to be the feelings, there's going to all these things you have to manage with them. So what you're trying to do is know this system, so that going in, there's always a winner, and the winner is you, because you've managed their state. You manage your client states?
Yeah, I mean, so one example would be, I shared a story with a couple of agents on the team. I went in with a buyer, they sold their home firm, we lost that in an offer, we responded back right away, we went in on another offer, we lost again, we responded right away, and we got them a house.
Beautiful.
But it was like a boom, 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 boom thing, boom.
Yeah.
And I didn't let, there was no cooling off period.
Right.
It was just on to the next one, boom, and you're getting in a house. Like, the outcome was you're
buying a house.
The outcome
is clear. This is what we're doing.
Period. So that was one example. Another example, and they've sent me 2 referrals since then, by the way, so that the business has now gone boom, boom, like that. The other thing would be when you're walking into a listing, having the mindset of I'm going to give 100% and that's all I can do versus I'm going to get in and get the listing, period.
Right.
Full stop.
Yes.
Like, there's nobody that's going to stop me from going in there and getting the listing. And I know some people make fun of me when I say you're physically going to have to remove me to get out of the house before the paperwork is signed because I'm not leaving. Because I know if I leave the house, there's a good chance I'm probably not going to get it. So I know that going in there, I am getting the listing, period. And that's what I'm there to do. I'm there to get a contract signed. So it's very clear about the outcome.
So let's just address the laundry list of mental health today. What's his model of the world?
He's a winner.
He's going to. What's his RES? It's completely switched on for one outcome, right? Like, what's his black and white? Any black in
it's
his...
It's all white.
It's all white. This is it, glossed over blacker. I mean, this is how it is, right? How does he protect himself?
With his mindset, his self-talk.
And mindset protection is what? What's he focused on?
Yeah.
100%. See, the thing about being a human being is we didn't come with a manual. We didn't come with a manual that says this is how we do it. So what's interesting is little training sessions like this are actually giving you the manual pieces, because that's really what we're trying to do. So here's another phrase in the mental mindset, or the mental toolbox. What you focus on expands. What you focus on expands in your awareness. What you focus on expands. So for example, if I focus on that marker, I can see all of you, but as I bring that closer and closer and closer, it expands into my awareness that it's almost all I see. So what you're focusing on, if you're focusing on good, good things happen and great things expand from that. If you're focusing on bad things happen and they expand. Does that make sense? What you're focusing on is going to expand into your awareness. So learning how to live with that in a powerful way is really key. So let's talk slightly about the concept of rumination. So this is the mental health side of us that is kind of the downward spiral. So to ruminate means to think upon something incessantly. You just think and think and think and think, and it moves to the point where you have no other thoughts except the thought of that thing. The average person has somewhere between 60 and 90,000 thoughts a day. That's a lot of thoughts. I mean, that's a lot of thoughts. Sadly, it's usually only about 1,000 different items or subjects. But they're 60 times that one item. I mean, they just ruminate and ruminate and ruminate. To ruminate means to focus on two C's. The first C is cause, or the second C is consequence. So rumination becomes negative when we focus on what caused it, or we focus on the consequence of it. As opposed to when we actually, to ruminate in a positive way means to think of everything else outside of the box. We want to focus on the outcome. To ruminate is to focus on what the consequence and causes. That's focusing on the past. There's nothing you can do about the past. Here's the big quote. Suffering only exists when you argue with what is. Suffering only exists when you argue with what is. From the great work of Byron Katie. And here's what that means. Is that when you don't accept reality, you will suffer. So when something happens, you hear people like me come say, it is what it is. How many people have heard people say, it is what it is? Some people hate that phrase. Right? Those are people who love to ruminate. Because they want to focus on consequence and cause, and this is going to happen, and that happened again, and blah, and you could just list it over and over again. Mm-hmm. Right? That's rumination. Someone who's actually in a high positive mental state goes, it is what it is. Nothing I can do about it. It is what it is. I'd like to be sad or hurt or angry. I am experiencing those emotions. I mean, you're allowed to do that, and that's healthy to do that, to get it out, but it is what it is. Do you know what I mean? Like, deal's lost. Okay, let's go to the next one. Let's go to the next one. Let's go to the next one. Like, he got clear in the outcome. It's like, you get in the house. That's where we get that nailed down. And which one we're going to get is going to be just a matter of circumstances now. We're just going to put everything in for, let's go. How many know if he let his couple think about, if we'd said this in the offer, if he gave them any time to ruminate, you know where they'd be? Right?
Still looking for a house.
No, they're still looking for a house, and worse, writing bad reviews about Adam. Right? Do you know what I'm saying? But he's intelligent enough to know, no. That we can't do anything about the past. It is what it is. We didn't get the offer. Let's move on to the next one. Next. He got clear on the, it is what it is. Suffering only exists if I argue with what this is. Yes, I know I lost that house. That's not important. Let's move on. That's magical. Suffering only exists when you argue with reality. If you can get anywhere near what I just said and put that into your life, you'll watch your happiness meter go vertical. Right? There's lots of tragedies we could focus on. We could look at all kinds of terrible things that happen in all of our lives, in all of their own unique ways. They're very meaningful to us. Right? But we only suffer when we argue with that reality. Or we put meaning or consequence on it. This means this, or this means that. Sometimes, if a stranger, third-party objective walks in and goes, so-and-so died, sorry. They don't have any attachment to it. You're like, but that means this. No, it doesn't. So-and-so died. That's what it means. And they look, it's like, what? How many know we attached a meaning to it? Do you know what I'm saying? When someone didn't get that house, it meant something to that person that was trying to buy the house. But I wanted this one because I like red brick. Really? Like, listen, like, if you attach a meaning to that, what happens if a white brick is up and it's even better and it has a better appreciation? You can make up whatever you want about anything. Would you agree? Mm-hmm. We get to select it. So in rumination, this is the magic key, is R, E plus R equals O. Questions, comments, potentially compliments. Anyone? I got you all drifting. All your you're all drifting.
E plus R equals O is just,
it's a formula.
Of everything that you've taught me, you've learned, whatever, that for me is such a defining thing and has changed everything for me, absolutely everything. And I'll just, when my after Terry died, and this is the power of the mind, I want a month off, I want time off in the summer, I want time off in the summer, because 3 summers before that, he had lots of time off. It just, the way the work went, right? I didn't really want it to be a month off planning my husband's funeral and getting over that, right? But you gotta be careful what you ask for, right? But I remember specifically laying in bed probably 2 weeks after it happened, and Jocelyn stayed with me for 2 weeks, and I can't remember if she was there or not, but I remember waking up and I thought, all right, he's died, and now I get to choose what I'm gonna do. I'm 33 years old, I've got at least 55 more years left on this planet. All right, I choose to be happy. And it kind of was as simple as that. Mm-hmm. Today I'm just gonna get up, I'm gonna shower, and then I'm gonna find something to do. But it's that defining thing in my response, because I could have chose to be the other way. And trust me, sometimes I do get that way, right? But it was so pivotal. It was, like, I remember the smell, that what was going on, where I was laying in bed, like, it was just that defining moment. Like, you always get to choose the outcome, right? So the outcome is that I'm happy. And I get to choose that every single day, right? And I get to choose to be in a loving relationship now that with somebody who's, like, incredible with me, you know what I mean? I get to choose that, because something didn't happen to me, it happened for me, and just kind of, I utilize that stuff all the time. Like, it was so powerful. I know I wouldn't be here today without that formula right there. For a full stop, full stop.
Well, I don't know if a testimony gets any better than that right there. I'm just gonna leave it like that.
Yeah.
You know, that's beautiful. Mm-hmm. That's beautiful.
For sure.
How many know that we all don't really have the capacity to imagine that, right? We can kind of pretend to put ourselves in it, but we haven't been there, right? Would you agree? So what we have is the choice to use these tools. There's a couple of things that I want to focus on how do you hold yourself in a positive mental state? And there are 4 key tools that I've discovered that do that. And besides this massive formula, which you notice, I spent a lot of time here because until this one's clear, you can really be a victim. You could really, if you don't choose that O properly, if you don't choose that outcome right, gosh, man, life can get rough. Yes, go ahead.
So if you're so in tune with, you know, your outcome and how you want things to be, and how do you confront it if someone else is just not, I guess you're going to go through that with all the your states, right? But if you're just in that mindset where, you know, you just create your outcome and it is going to be what you want it to be, mm-hmm. but someone else is there, you know, challenging it.
Sure.
Like, how do you stay positive in that mindset to not let them, you know, bring you down to that dark spot, right?
So I like the 90-day rule. So here's what it is that... in my relationships, in my world, I have things called boundaries, right? So for example, if I had a relationship with, I'll use Adam, right? So if Adam's a jerk to me on day one, I kind of go, oh, that's, you know, he's having a bad day, and then he's a jerk to me 7 days later, and then a month later, and he's just consistently a jerk for 90 days.
Yeah.
Not in alignment with my values, my beliefs, the things that are core to me. He's not in my model of the world of what a good friend is. I'm gonna step into that around the 30, 60, 90. I have a boundaries. I allow everyone that I, because I'm a loving, supporting, loving, kind person, I'm like, oh, you know, Jen can have a bad day, Adam can have a bad day. I'm cool with that. But if it's consistent, it shows time, eventually that when I don't address that, that becomes a boundary issue about my own self-love. It's like, Adam, you need to stop talking to me that way, because that's not working. Like, you know, we're friends, but you can't speak to me that way, right? I've had to say that to my mother, my father, my grandmother, my grandfather. I've had to say it to my, never had to say it to my sister. I must really like her. but I've never, like, I've had to say it to close friends. Eventually I had to say, I don't know how to say this, but I've asked you 4 times not to do that. You know, we've been doing this for 3 months now, Adam. Like, dude, like, I can't do this anymore. Why 90 days? Good question. I'm glad you asked.
Yeah. I was getting there.
So here's how, this is just my model of the world, and this is what I've observed. The Harvard science says that if I try a habit on, by the way, the science on how you have a habit, 21 days, actually comes from, they gave kids at Harvard glasses that had prisms that had they had to keep on, they taped them on, they couldn't take them off, and the prisms made the world look upside down. Right? So imagine walking every day and the world was upside down. How many of that'd be a little bit rough? It took 21 days for the brain to rewire itself so that looking through that prism, the world was the right way up. 21 days. They took the glasses off, right? Inverted the prisms, right? Right? It took 21 days to do what? Those kids were messed up.
That was pretty cool.
So,
right.
But how many, like, that'd be pretty trippy, would you agree?
Yeah.
Well, they figured out that the wiring the mind, the habits, the way that we see the world, take about 21 days. So they take that in. So when I think about what I call a 3 or 4 week period, depending on how much reinforcement. So I could help you change a habit. I'd hold you there for 21 to 28 days. I'd hold you there. That's like, okay, I gotcha, right? If there are not a lot of support around you, you're gonna need a good 60 days. If you're in an isolated, alone, but there's like all these people who are negative around you, you're about 90 days. In 90 days, you either have to change your environment or you're not gonna make it. So when people come to me and say, how come I'm not getting what I want in my life? Number one, I'm making the observation that you probably don't have a lot of support. Number two is that negative enforcement, it's the antithesis. You want X, they want Y. Does it make sense? There's this constant push-pull. And because you have a fear somewhere in that relationship that you can't communicate or hold the boundary, how many know that when I set up a boundary and say, don't cross that line, the very first thing that they're going to do is test the line. They're going to say, there.
Huh. What do you think of that?
You have kids? Yeah, they're masters. You know who's more of a master?
Yeah.
Me. Like, push it. Actually, I want to give you a timeout. Go ahead. I'm standing here. Go! And they're like, don't mess with dad. He's nuts. I mean, yeah, I know. But see, with dad, it's like I know the responsibility of father is to actually be the authority on the inside of our home unless they meet the authorities on the outside of our home. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So I create the authority in the home so they don't have to meet the authorities outside my home. Does everyone follow along?
Yeah.
No different for you. The authority in your world is you. This is what I believe, this is what I stand for, this is my model of the world, this is what I'll fight for, this is what I value, this is what I believe. If you are not in this with me, you have to make a decision at that point. Either they're with you or they're not. And you have to say, I'm sorry, I don't know how to express this in any other way, but this is what I want to have in my life. And if you're not a supporter of that, then I have to do something which is I don't want to do, but I have to emancipate you. Do you know what the word emancipate means? To pluck from existence. You see, when I give somebody my heart, my soul, my relationship, my friendship with them, I offer them control. That their word is of value to me. Right? When Dan is my friend or Tammy is my friend, they call me and we talk about things. I value them, much like they value my word. If I ever abuse that relationship, they would sense it and they would feel it. Right? Just the same way that, you know, if they said anything, I'd be like, when we open up our heart, right, we open ourselves up to their value, their contribution. So when we offer that up as the gift, and they abuse that gift, then you need to communicate, like Jocelyn said, well, why did you say that? That hurt me, right? She wasn't hurt. She was experiencing sadness from someone that she'd handed the keys to. Said, listen, this thing's open. Like, be careful, eh?
I even used to, like, when I was younger, I used to tell a lot of people, like people I meet or whatever, I say, look,
I'll give you 100% of my trust, my love unconditional. It's up to you to keep it that way.
And the only thing I would add to that is, and here's a laundry list of things that break trust. Because when you don't give them the laundry list, their model of the world may be like, well, I can tell jokes about you behind your back. And you're like, no, that's number three on my laundry list, and you're screwed. Yeah. You see what I'm saying? Like, Adam has a great relationship with Gino, right? Because they sit and they you know, they bug each other. What do they call that? They rib each other all the time. They're always constantly bugging each other, right? They joke around. But they've said on their laundry list, it's okay to make fun of each other. Because Gino would throw a couple of good ones across the room, right?
Oh, of course.
Yeah. But they've set that up, that bantering. Yeah. Right? But there's a couple of lines that they both won't cross. Right? I don't know what they are because they don't only know that themselves, right? But like,
we're still trying to figure out what those lines are.
This is probably not working.
Yeah.
but you see, opening yourself up that way is huge, right? And that person who's not supporting you, how much are they affecting your thoughts?
Yeah.
It's like it's consuming you. And it's forcing you into rumination, and it's difficult to be objective of that subjective experience you're having. It's like, this is hurting me, this is upsetting me, right? And now what happens is your life is being consumed by this person who's not supporting you. So, you know, I tell people, you're 30, 60, 90 days, set the boundaries up, say, listen, if we can't get clear on this, I have to move on, I can't have this in my space. It doesn't work. I didn't see my grandmother for many, many years. I was sitting, you guys know the story, right? I think I've shared this story, but anyways, I set up a boundary with my grandmother that she could not call my mother an idiot in my presence. I said, that's my mother. I know you're her mother, but that's my mother, right? You can't stand in my home and tell my mother she's an idiot, because I have to punch you in the face, because that's a part of my laundry list of boundary breakers. Don't call my mother an idiot. Does everyone follow along? It sounds as crazy as that. Now I'll throw the wrench that it's her mother that's doing it. So I said, you're not welcome. If you can stay here, you can come every day for the rest of your life. But you refer to my mother in a derogatory fashion by belittling her or speaking ill of her in my presence, or let alone the presence of my children, who are now 3 and 4, I'm like, I'm sorry, you have a problem. And it has nothing to do with my mother. Well, of course, she never came back, because she wouldn't give up the right to call her daughter an idiot. I mean, that's kind of weird, right? But it worked out just fine for me, because I knew what the boundary was and who held the boundary. That's the boundary. Can't cross it. Sorry, love you, but you have to go somewhere else and do that, whatever that is.
100% clarity on the.
Oh, it's clear. Boom, yeah. Boom. It was like a I always do this. It's like a guillotine. How many have ever seen a real live guillotine? Big lead weight, big like it just cut it, bang. And you know what? Like, just if you exit it, you can't imagine how much more happy your life is.
It is important to deliver boundaries in a loving way, though.
Oh, it is.
And then to stick to what you've set out.
Yeah, it's so hard.
I can remember setting a boundary with a family member as well, who was always very pessimistic and negative. And I was going through some serious health issues at the time, and my mental state of being was extremely important. So I started to set boundaries with quite a few people, oddly enough, in your family, in my family. And I can remember getting up in the middle of a lunch and asking for a to-go container and my sister being like, what's happening? And I said, I expressed to you before that when you are negative this way, it sucks me in, it brings me down, and I can't afford that state of mind. And I expressed to you very lovingly that if you did it, I could no longer spend time with you. And I had to enforce the boundary 3 times, and it never happened again.
Yeah.
She never in my presence talks about anything derogatory or negative, and if she does, she asks me, you know, like, can I just, you know, vent or guess? Absolutely, yep, no, I'm in a good place, you get that off your chest, and then we move on.
Yeah.
It's a completely different relationship now.
Yeah. Boundaries are a very powerful subject. Maybe we'll add them to next month, because I think it's important, especially with emotions. There are 4 things that control your, this is just what I think, that can support your mental health. The first one is something called mantras. Mantras were created as a part of something called the auto-suggestion. In 1913, a guy named Emile Coué, who was a French psychologist, was the first person who discovered the power of auto-suggestion, where he'd have clients come into the clinic, and he'd say, and he put them in what he called an entrainment or entranced state. And he'd say to them, repeat after me. Every day, in every way, I'm getting better and better. Every day, in every way. In 1913, he created the Lorraine Society for Psychology, and it became a foundational piece of work that literally has changed life as we kind of know it, because he brought forward into kind of the public domain the power of autosuggestion, the ability to say every day and every way, I'm getting better and better. Every day in every way, every day in every way, I'm getting better and better. Just think about what that sounds like in your own head. If you even said it out loud, you're in your car driving, every day in every way, I'm getting better and better. That's known as a mantra. And a mantra is a powerful system of support because it's built on the auto-suggestion, right? That's different than the next form of support, which is known as an affirmation. So as a mantra is repeating the same thing over in an entranced state. An affirmation is a positively written statement that's usually written from a personal perspective, and it's subjective. It's your in the present time, right? I'll give you an example of mine, right? One of the things that I affirm all the time in my life is traveling the world, I enjoy relationships with powerful, famous, and influential people. Traveling the world, I enjoy relationships with powerful, famous, and influential people. How many know I love to travel? I leave to California tomorrow. I'm excited. But I've been traveling my whole life. Ever since many years ago, in fact, probably 15 years ago, I just started saying, I travel all the time. I love to travel. Traveling the world, I enjoy, you know, meeting powerful, famous, and influential people, right? I just started speaking that out. And I made sure it was personal, present tense, and it was speaking something that was very personal to me. The affirmation should always be written by self, and each word should be selected so it has meaning and outcome for you, just like that. So you have an outcome that really gives you what you're looking for. The third tool, a very powerful tool, and really became very popular as a part of the psychological study. It happened in the year 2000 as a part of the positive psychology movement, and it's the study of gratitude. Gratitude statements are quickly becoming a physiological shift in statements. So if I were to have you think about something you're grateful for, they could put you on a machine and physically watch all the cells in your body start to shift. So this is newer science, but gratitude statements, before you go to bed thinking of five things you're grateful for, waking up every day, waking up and think, stopping in the middle of the day and just thinking, what are you grateful for? Gratitude statement changes physiology. I'm talking about cellular membrane, right? Just stopping and thinking about something you're grateful for. How many are grateful for the warm weather outside? Yes, right? So as soon as I said that, all of you went, right? Because the body goes, it's like the yummy meal, right? Every time you have a gratitude statement. Right, and I can't encourage people enough that if you're in a darker space, gratitude is one of the most powerful ways to shift state. Is gratitude statements very powerful? The fourth is one that's been known for thousands and thousands of years, but we know it as meditation. Meditation is can come in multiple types. There's relaxation meditation, which is the emptying of the mind to get rid of content for the beingness of just arriving at nothingness. That's one model of the world of meditation. There's a different type of meditation, which tends to be more new age, which is the meditation for life force. It's known as chi or energy. We're actually focusing in meditation, bringing in to like total clarity, like to the ball of power, and you expand it out from yourself. So meditation can be used for relaxation, or meditation can be used for complete empowerment, or it can be used for any other system in between. Stopping and just taking the time to actually just be in those moments, and whether you're using the new technologies of HoloSync or any types of what they call binaural beats. Binaural beats is two frequencies playing slightly off that forces the left part of your brain and the right part of your brain to come together to make sense of the signal. So why do you want to listen to binaural beats? Binaural beats force the brain to come into synchronicity. We have a left brain and we have a right brain. I mean, now we have a left and right brains, right? Each one of those are designed. One gives us logic, one gives us creativity. When we spend too much time in logic, we tend to ruminate. When we spend too much time in creativity, we tend to float, right? We don't get a lot done, but boy, we have a great time. Mm-hmm. So, and the secret is to bring both of them together. One of the most powerful frequencies on the earth is the number 432 hertz. 400. It was better known as the middle C. How many know it hit the boom on the middle C note, right? That note resonates so deeply inside the human body. It's very, very powerful. Unfortunately, 300 years ago, the Germans decided to move that note up from 432 to 440 hertz because it was better mathematically, right? So it's interesting, if you can ever get hold of 432 hertz, just Google it, you'll see it. Meditation, 432. It's a tone that comes in. You'll feel your whole, your inner core just kind of start to vibrate with it. If you're not, if you're out of kind of out of your, you know, if you're not used to meditation, you'll probably find that it'll take a while to get back in sync. But you'll find that you'll have a very, very beautiful state of, if you're in a very high stress state, meditating with sound and tonal waves, specifically binaural beats, will bring you back to peace. Your goal is to bring the left and the right hemispheres together so that you're thinking with whole mind, not partial mind, right? How many have ever got into your logic state? You're like just numbers and fast and calculating and, right? And then there are other times you're just creative and floative and creative ideas and thinking, right? You can actually test to figure which part of your brain you're in right now. Do you know that? Check the left, check the right now. One of them slightly plugged. Which one is it?
This one.
Is that on your?
That's on my
left side. Right, so you're actually in your right. So you're right now, you're kind of relaxed and creative, right? If we check her a little later on today, it'll be the other side, where she's sitting there like this in the computer and thinking of all these ideas. I mean, she'll switch over, right? So the opposite, whatever's plugged is the opposite, which brain you're in.
So what is it, left side is
left side is logic. Yeah, so if left side is plugged, you tend to be in the right creative.
Creative.
Right, so whatever, it's the opposite of what's plugged. Powerful. So today we covered model of the world, we talked about mind projection fallacy, we talked about the reticular activation system, we talked about the power of black and white thoughts and how it produces gray, we talked about protecting ourselves, we talked about what we think about expands, we talked about objective subject reality, we talked about rumination, we talked about the importance of E plus R equals O, we talked about the use of that, and obviously we get the best testimony ever, and then we talked about the four creative tools to help guide you to the highest positive states of mental health. Questions, comments, compliments? Takeaways. Okay, one sentence from everybody. Everyone has to participate. Jen starts. Go ahead.
My takeaway is how rumination and logic associate with E plus R equals O. So understanding that, you know, I always understood you have to get out of trying to figure out how things are going to happen. I mean, I learned that, one of the first things I learned from you. But understanding that the how, you know, if you sit and ruminate, so I have a situation in my life right now. If I sit and ruminate on the situation and how it can be fixed or can't be fixed and other people's opinions and my opinions, then that's all I'm going to get stuck in. There's no moving forward from that.
Because you're focusing
on
cause or consequence.
When you just focus on the outcome, I don't care how I'm getting there, I'm getting there. I don't care what you say or what is or what people's opinion of what can and can't, I'm just getting there. And all that focus is there, then you're away from here. And you can relate that to my clients in real estate. So you have people losing out on multiples and you have them focusing on, oh, why did that happen or how they're feeling about it. Or you can't, you know, it has to be a conversation about, in this market, so many people have to change their criteria in order to move forward and get into a house. You can lose that client right there. If they don't understand, that's done, this is what we've realized, this is the awareness. Now, what can we do to move forward away from what's
what is
been, yeah, of what is. It's the only way to keep going. And that's, it's just awesome how it all connects.
It is.
It's great. Amazing.
Great. Adam.
Losing is temporary, winning is a mindset.
Oh, I love that.
Yeah.
That's beautiful.
You said one sentence.
Did I say it? I love that.
Sorry, that
is.
Totally
small,
that.
Long
I'm
sentence.
Sorry.
Glenn, one sentence.
It was a run-on.
Comma.
Nothing has meaning unless you give meaning to it.
Very nice. Very nice. Very good. Vanessa, take away.
Come back to me for one sentence.
Excellent.
I've got a bunch of
okay.
I thought it was actually really cool, the question that Ashley brought up, just like about boundaries and how you can be so set on that outcome and how other people can infringe upon that reaction and can drag you down and just to be super clear on your boundaries and allow it that time, but to be really clear on your non-negotiables, because it can really affect your outcome for sure.
It can affect everything.
Yeah.
Probably the same thing, Ashley, mentioning that, and you saying that you need to have your list, because everybody is different.
You gotta get a list.
And they don't know what they don't know, so you need to tell them what your boundaries are.
Beautiful. Thank you. Joss?
I got a lot today. Ironically, it was one of those days that this was exactly what I needed.
I'm shocked.
You seem to do that often. Today was a kicker for sure. So the biggest thing, I think, not being in sadness, however experiencing sadness, knowing that it is not me, because me is happy, loving, fun, and kind, and awesome.
I love it.
And you are, Joss.
And you are.
Like everyone looking at their notes on their phone. Your takeaway?
See, we're listening to you. I'm writing.
Oh, it's cool. I appreciate it.
Again, today was great for me too. I got a lot of takeaway today. Most importantly, I think it was like how Gino's example with the RAS thing. I was always like, oh, if I see this car one time and I love it, then you see it everywhere. I never knew what that was or how to like apply that to. So now I'm more self-aware of things. And especially another takeaway was suffering only exists when you argue with what is reality, and that's very, very important to me as well, because I tend to just stay so much in my emotions and so I just need to get out of that and look differently.
Yes, good stuff. Brenda?
I said it earlier, E plus R equals O for sure. Just a great reminder how this stuff is so important to your mental state.
Beautiful.
I think there's a lot of them, but for me, one of them was...
Timmy's cringing over there.
It's marks on the wall.
It's like a recliner.
The nature of the part.
He's getting dental work.
Event response.
Response outcome.
Very...
Yeah. For me, I think there was a lot, but one in particular was learn how to protect yourself from yourself. Because I think we are, and can be, and are our worst opponents.
Mm-hmm. Of course, yeah.
So just learn not to defeat yourself, and everything's going to be good.
It always is. Beautiful.
For me, definitely E plus R equals O, and I think just realizing how you can apply that literally everywhere.
Everywhere.
My business, myself, my kids, my one child has the worst reactions to every single situation. So even helping him, like using that with him. And again, the statement, suffering only exists when you argue with what is. I think that's huge for myself and my child too. Like, he literally suffers with every single thing that happens to him. Like the video games that you mentioned, like huge. It's the end of the world when he loses a video game or... told me the other day, they're writing comic books, and this kid at school told them that he's not allowed to write comic books with him anymore, and it was literally the end of the world for him. He was devastated. And it was like, okay, well, write your own comic books then. He's like, oh, great, perfect. So, but like, just those little things, like, and applying E plus R equals O everywhere would be, definitely helpful.
Very good. Dick?
I think I'm going to go with E plus R equals O as well. Just due to the fact of what Mal said, it can apply to every situation, right? And the road rage thing was one thing that I kind of thought about. Not that I get road rage, or just like, but like, why is that guy flipping me off if I'm going a little bit slower, which doesn't usually happen to me, but it was, the way you put it, I was going fast, right? But no, just the analogy that you used, thinking like, what happened to that guy that's making him react that way to me for something that is completely irrelevant to what's going on, essentially, right?
It's so beautiful. Yes. Many.
I really liked that nothing happens to you, but everything happens for you.
Sure does. Very nice. Shannon?
That we teach ourselves to look for what we want to find, which helps you stay in either negative thought or positive thought. And we always teach our kids to think of like a tree. When something happens, which branch are you going to go out on? The negative branch or the positive branch?
Brilliant. Good.
E plus R equals O is one, and then there's no right or wrong, but thinking is something.
Yeah. Nothing's neither good nor bad. I like Bill. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay.
For me,
just having healthy interruptions in life, like sometimes when you have those rumination time periods, just recognizing it in others to be able to like almost drop something and went, like, let's interrupt that there and break that thought process and then bring them back into the context of where I want them to be with the outcome, focus on the outcome. So, like, I've done that a lot of times in my own life, but it's learning how to do that in others.
Beautiful.
Whether it be clients or, you know, people that I'm around.
It's called a pattern interrupt. And it's actually used by psychologists and psychiatrists and doctors. Like, you know who uses, who's infamous for it is Tony Robbins. And you know how he does it? He drops F-bombs like they're going out of style. Like, he's like, F this, F, and people are like, boop, boop, and anyone who's not used to, if you've never been in Tony's events, he'll drop F-bombs and like crazy language all up, and you'll be like, why is he doing that? Because he's constantly breaking state. And the reason why is because when people go down that little alley, and then if they keep going down that thing, like, he needs to break state because he's got to keep bringing you into the present in order for him to be able to do the work he wants to do with you.
That's why I do that.
Yeah, you drop. I drop F-bombs. I break state.
You didn't realize how powerful you were. Like,
your clients love it. kidding.
It's funny talking about that when the kids were little, and I remember being in a store one time, and Brooke was really little, and it was summer, and she decided she should bite me on the inside of my leg in a store and would not let go. And I remember thinking, oh my gosh. But it was that pattern interrupt, like, okay, I can either react to what she's doing.
Oh my god.
Or like it was the most bizarre, but it was that interrupt, like
bang.
Oh yeah. It was, and even we have a puppy now, training a puppy. It's the same thing, like he'll bite you, and if the vet said yelp back, like he's hurting you. And if you yelp at him, he like looks around like, where's the other dog? Like, it's so bizarre, because I thought, okay, lady, you're nuts. But then after getting bit a few times, I'm like, okay, I'll try this. And it really
works
with him. Like he's just like, ooh, yeah.
How many have seen the grocery store commercial where the kid grabs the baggages? I want this,
yeah.
And then the mother walks over and says, oh yeah? She grabs it, and she gets up there, and the mother's on the floor.
Yeah.
She gets up, looks at him, puts it, and the kid puts the chips back. He's like, yeah. Pattern interrupt, right? It's a break state. So.
And the other thing, just when people are in their response, remember, it has nothing to do with you.
Oh, that's a beauty, isn't it?
And that kind of goes hand in hand with kids.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah, I mean, people are doing their stuff, right? Yeah, you know, just don't make sure it's not personal. Don't take anything personally. Take it professionally. That's been always my big line. It's like, don't take it personally. Take it professionally. So, awesome day.
Thanks, guys.
Good stuff. Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.